Good morning. Today, my topic of the day for today is dementia, etiology, clinical features and management. And my moderator is Chetan, sir. So today we will start with the topic of what is dementia. As we all know, dementia is a clinical syndrome due to disease of the brain, usually chronic and progressive, in which there is a disturbance in multiple higher cortical functions, including the memory, thinking and orientation, comprehension, calculation, language, learning ability and judgment. This is by the ICD-10 by WHO, the definition of dementia. Dementia is a cognitive function, declines. It is a condition in which the cognitive function declines with aging. It's an age-related decline with cognitive speed and working memory. And general knowledge and vocabulary stable or improve while problem solving and reasoning will usually decline. Dementia is usually characterized by multiple cognitive deficits of sufficient severity to interfere with the function during the daily activities. And the DSM-5 criteria describe cognitive impairment and dementia in neurocognitive disorders. An essential part of assessment of dementia is exclusion of depression or delirium, according to the new DSM-5 criteria. So the new DSM-5 updated the prior criteria for dementia. And we also have another criteria, that is a mild neurocognitive disorder and major neurocognitive disorder, that is dementia. Mild cognitive impairment, that is, it is in between state of normal aging and dementia. In mild cognitive impairment, cognitive change is greater than expected for age, and independence and ADL are preserved. So this is the difference between mild cognitive impairment with amnestic and mild cognitive impairment non-amnestic. The cognitive decline with intact ADLs often corroborated by an informant. Memory impairment and multi-domain and MCI if other domains are involved. And here we have in mild cognitive impairment non-amnestic, we have cognitive decline with intact ADLs often corroborated by an informant. Non-memory cognitive impairment, that is language, attention, executive function, visuospatial, and multi-domain NAMCI if more than one other non-memory domain is involved. So here the subtyping MCI into amnestic and non-amnestic categories has a predictive value. The vast majority of AMCI is mainly because of Alzheimer's dementia, and non-MCI is mainly because of other diseases such as vascular dementia, Lewy body disease, or it can also be due to Alzheimer's dementia. So the mild cognitive MCI is usually, there is an annual risk in the elderly, that is general population 1 to 2%, and MCI in clinical setting it's about 10 to 15%, and in population based studies 5 to 10%. A diagnosis of MCI even with reversion to normal has prognostic value. This is the DSM-4 criteria for dementia, and this is the DSM-5 criteria for major neurocognitive disorder, which was previously dementia. So memory impairment. For dementia, DSM-4 criteria, there is memory impairment. At least one of the following, there is aphasia, apraxia, agnosia, or disturbance in excessive executive functioning. And B, the cognitive deficits in A1 and A2 each cause significant impairment in social or occupational functioning and represent a significant decline from a previous level of functioning. The cognitive deficits do not occur exclusively during the course of delirium. In DSM-5 criteria for major neurocognitive disorder, is evidence of significant cognitive decline from a previous level of performance in one or more cognitive domains, that is learning and memory, language, executive function, complex attention, perceptual motor and social cognition. And B, the cognitive deficits interfere with the independence in everyday activities. At a minimum, assistance should be required with complex instrumental activities of daily living, such as paying bills or managing medications. And C, the cognitive deficits do not occur exclusively in the context of a delirium. And for D, the cognitive deficits are not better explained by another mental disorder, from a major depressive disorder, schizophrenia, etc. So when we come to the classification based on the cause for dementia, so what are the causes? The majority is the Alzheimer's disease, which occupies about 60% of all the causes. followed by cerebrovascular diseases, that is making us 20% of all causes. So, and multi-infarct, that is atherosclerotic dementia, and subcortical vascular disease, that is Binswanger's disease. Then comes the neurodegenerative, that is such as Pick's disease, Huntington's chorea, Parkinson's disease, so, and infections, such as Creutzfeldt-Jakob's disease, HIV, that is the AIDS dementia complex, viral encephalitis, progressive multifocal leukoencephalopathy. Then it can also be caused by normal pressure hydrocephalus, nutritional, such as Wernicke-Korsakoff, thiamine deficiency, B12 deficiency, folate deficiency. Seventh is metabolic, that is hepatic disease, thyroid disease, parathyroid disease, Cushing syndrome, chronic inflammatory conditions such as collagen vascular disease and vasculitis, multiple sclerosis, trauma such as head injury, punch drunk syndrome, and tumor, example subfrontal meningioma. Some cases are treatable and about 10 to 15% are reversible. So when classification based on the site of the brain where this occurs, in the anterior, that is the frontal premotor cortex, it usually is causes behavioral changes, that is the loss of inhibition, antisocial behavior, facile and responsible. Example, normal pressure hydrocephalus, Huntington's chorea, and metabolic disease. When it occurs in the posterior aspect of the brain, that is the parietal and temporal lobes, disturbance of cognitive function, memory and language without marked changes in behavior, like Alzheimer's disease. In subcortical type, it's mainly because of apathetic, that is a forgetful and slow, poor ability to use knowledge. So it's associated with other neurological signs and movement disorders. Example, Parkinson's disease and dementia and AIDS dementia complex. And fourth is cortical, that is higher cortical abnormalities, such as dysphasia, agnosia, apraxia, same as in Alzheimer's disease. So posterior and cortical is more seen in Alzheimer's disease, and other anterior and subcortical in other diseases. Now coming to the cause, Alzheimer's disease, which causes the most number of dementia. So when we say about Alzheimer's disease, it's a degenerative brain disorder of unknown etiology, which usually starts in the late middle age or old age. It results in progressive memory loss, impaired thinking, disorientation, and changes in personality and mood. And there is degeneration of brain neurons, especially the cerebral cortex, and presence of neurofibrillary tangles and plaques containing beta amyloid cells. The origin of Alzheimer's disease is that the disease was just out of curiosity. The disease was first described by Dr. Alois Alzheimer, a German physician, in 1906. Alzheimer's had a patient named Auguste D. in her 50s who suffered from what seemed like a mental illness. But when she died in 1906, an autopsy revealed dense deposits, now called neuritic plaques, outside and around the nerve cells in her brain. Inside the cells were twisted strands of fiber or neurofibrillary tangles. Since Dr. Alois Alzheimer's was the first person who discovered the disease, Alzheimer's disease was named after him. The neurochemical factors are basically the acetylcholine, somatostatin, substance P, and norepinephrine. The environmental factors that cause Alzheimer's is cigarette smoking, certain infections, metals, industrials, or other toxins, and use of cholesterol-lowering drugs such as statins. In genetic and immunological factors, oxidized LDL receptor 1 and angiotensin 1 converting enzyme are tied to the way the brain cells bind to apolipoprotein 4 and reduce buildup of harmful proteins known as plaques in the brain, respectively. And the risk factors are basically Down syndrome, especially second is family history, chronic high BP, head injuries, gender, smoking, and drinking. In the pathophysiology of Alzheimer's is that the Alzheimer's disease attacks the nerves and brain cells as well as the neurotransmitters, and the destruction of these parts causes clumps of protein to form around the brain cells, and these clumps are known as plaques and bundles, and the presence of plaques and bundles start to destroy more connections between the brain cells, which makes the conditions worse. Due to the etiological factors, now we're coming to pathophysiology. Due to the etiological factors, changes occur in the proteins of the nerve cells of the cerebral cortex, the accumulation of neurofibrillary tangles and plaques. and which leads to granular vascular degeneration and loss of cholinergic nerve cells and loss of memory function and leads to loss of memory function and cognition. So this is a normal, in one side, on the left side, you can see the normal neurons, and here we have the amyloid plaques that we can see in the right side picture. This is the neurofibric tangles inside, and this is the amyloid plaques present here. The enzymes act on the amyloid precursor protein and cut into fragments, and the beta amyloid fragment is crucial in the formation of senile plaques in Alzheimer's disease. In Alzheimer's disease, the changes in tau protein lead to the disintegration of microtubules in brain cells. Now, coming to what are the signs, the 10 warning signs that we usually have to see in patients in Alzheimer's. Example, the patients come to the OPD, and what are the signs that we should look for? The 10 warning signs. First is memory loss. Progressive memory loss will be present, and difficulty. The second one is the difficulty to performing familiar tasks, the tasks which he had previously done, now he will have difficulty in doing, and the problems with language. That the language which he uses or his mother tongue, he will have problem with that language, and he may be disoriented to the time and place, and he will have a poor or decreased judgment. He will also have problems with abstract thinking, misplaced thing. He will keep on misplacing his things, and changes in mood or behavior, and changes in personality, and there will also will be a loss of initiative. So this is the 10 signs which you usually have to see as a 10 warning signs of Alzheimer's disease. What are the diagnostic tests that we can use for Alzheimer's disease? One is psychiatric assessments, and then we can do a mini mental status examination and a neuropsychological assessment. Laboratory tests can be done, brain imaging, especially the CT scan, MRI, PET and SPECT, CSF examination, electroencephalogram, EEG or electromyogram. Now, coming to the pharmacological intervention of Alzheimer's disease, as we all know, acetylcholinesterase inhibitors, they prevent the breakdown of acetylcholine, a chemical messenger important for learning and memory. Example, donepezil, rivastigmine, and galantamine. So, the example, memantine blocks N-methyl-D-aspartate receptor antagonist. Example, memantine usually blocks the NMDA receptor and inhibit their overstimulation by glutamine. And such as antidepressants can also be used in some cases. Anxiolytics, antipsychotics, and anticonvulsants can also be used, which can also act on Alzheimer's patient. It basically reduces their mood swings and symptoms. Now, coming to the second cause of dementia, which is the vascular dementia. By definition, a dementia syndrome likely the consequence of lesions of the brain. And vascular inorganism, irrespective of the ischemic, hemorrhagic, or hypoxic nature, it can be because of a thrombotic event, infarct, or a hemorrhage. But vascular dementia is a condition in which, because due to strokes, the patient suffers from dementia. The pathophysiology that can be characterized by many possible origins and etiologies and subtypes. Many pathophysiology can occur in multi-infarct dementia, strategic single infarct dementia. Third is the small vessel disease with dementia. Fourth is the hyperperfusion dementia. Fifth is the hemorrhagic dementia. And sixth is the other vascular dementias. The DSM-4 uncomplicated vascular dementias, that is the DSM criteria, that is the development of multiple cognitive deficits manifested by both A1, that is the memory of impairment, that is the impaired ability to learn new information or to recall previously learned information, and A2, that is one or more of the following cognitive disturbances. And aphasia, that is, so in A2, there is one is aphasia, that is language disturbance. Second is apraxia, that is impaired ability to carry out motor activities despite intact motor function. Third is agnosia, that is a failure to recognize or identify objects despite intact sensory function. And fourth is disturbance in executive functioning, that is planning, organizing, sequencing, abstracting. And B, that is the cognitive deficit syndrome criteria A1 and A2 each cause significant impairment in social or occupational functioning and represent a significant and decline from a previous level of functioning. And C, focal neurological signs and symptoms, that is example exaggeration of deep tendon reflexes, exterior plantar response, pseudobulbar palsy, gait abnormalities, weaknesses of extremity or laboratory evidence indicative of cerebrovascular disease, that is example multiple infarctions involving cortex and underlying white matter that are judged to be etiologically related to the disturbance. And D, the deficits do not occur exclusively during the course of a delirium. The other relevant DSM classifications, that is complicated types, three other types based on predominant feature of the dementia can be diagnosed using DSM-IV criteria. There is vascular dementia with delirium, vascular dementia with delusions, and vascular dementia with depressed mood. If there are significant behavior disturbance occurs as a result of the dementia, then that disturbance is specified. And what are the, now coming, what are the symptoms of vascular dementia? So the first of all, there will be cognitive. When we take out the cognitive, it's basically the confusion, disorientation. Then there will be trouble remembering, difficulty in deciding what to do next, and there will be trouble in concentration. Then there will be emotionally, we basically will be depression. It's not we also seen in Alzheimer's as well. Then we have conduct, that is the restlessness and agitation. Then coordination usually occurs in unsteady gait, walking at night, and walking at night as well, and physical sudden or frequent urge to urinate, unable to control urination. These are the physical symptoms of vascular dementia. And the labs, the initial labs that we use for vascular dementia are CBC, ESR, blood glucose, RFT, LFT, serology, vitamin B12, folate, TFT, CT or MRI. Other tests to consider is lupus anticoagulant, antiphospholipid and antinuclear antibody. The emerging test that we usually then do is also an echocardiogram. The general treatment, the focus of treatment is to slow the progression of dementia. And this type of dementia, such as vascular dementia, has no cure. The most common way is to prevent further strokes by controlling or eliminating the risk factors. And treatment includes diet, controlling of hypertension, aspirin therapy, smoking cessation, avoidance of heavy alcohol and stress reduction. Smoking drugs are used to treat mild Alzheimer's disease are being studied for their effectiveness in treating vascular dementia. Now coming to the pharmacological treatment, there is cholinesterase inhibitors such as donepezil, galantamine and rivastigmin. It usually prevents acetylcholine breakdown and thus increases the amount of available acetylcholine, which is involved in memory and judgment. And others such as memantine, which antagonizes the NMDA glutamate receptors, which are important for information processing, storage and retrieval. Now coming to other type of dementias, the neurodegenerative dementia, example the Pick's disease, Huntington's disease and Parkinson's disease. Now coming to Parkinson's disease, as we know, the Parkinson's disease progresses. It often results in progressive dementia, which is similar to dementia with Lewy bodies or Alzheimer's. And the symptoms is that there will be problems with movement, which are common symptom early in the disease. And if dementia develops, symptoms are often similar to dementia with Lewy's bodies. And the main symptoms would be resting tremor, akinetic rigidity, bent posture, and hypomemia. And the brain changes. There will be alpha-synuclein clumps are likely to begin in the area deep in the brain called the substantia nigra. These clumps are thought to cause degeneration of nerve cells that produce dopamine. So in Parkinson's disease, dementia, it is progressive disease. There is no particular treatment for Parkinson's disease. But some treatments such as cholinesterase inhibitor rivastigmin is approved for this condition. However, there remains a need to continue research in new and better treatments, in particular those that affect the disease. This is only symptomatic. It can't completely cure the disease. Now coming to Pick's disease, that is usually presents with impairment of recent memory associated with entorhinal cortex and hippocampal dysfunction. The Pick's disease typically affects the frontal and or anterolateral temporal lobes. And it's a type of frontotemporal dementia, and emotional and behavioral changes, mutism, aphasia, Echolalia, that is repeating whatever spoken to them, and rigidity, apraxia, weakness and memory loss. So these are the symptoms. And the what are the brain changes we usually see is that Pick's disease is defined pathologically by severe atrophy, neuronal loss and gliosis. And frequently the Pick's disease is accompanied by the occurrence of tau positive inclusions and swollen, that is balloon neurons, that is what we call the Pick cells, and argentinophilic neuronal inclusions known as Pick bodies can disproportionately affect the frontal and temporal cortical regions. And fewer Pick bodies may be present in these regions if the primary symptoms are behavior, that is, such as behavior variant Pick's disease, compared with the primary symptoms of aphasia. Pick's disease is a progressive dementia and it also has no particular treatment as such. Now coming to the dementia caused by infections. We have the Creutzfeldt-Jakob disease, HIV infection, that is what we call as the AIDS dementia complex, the viral encephalitis and the progressive multifocal leukoencephalopathy. Coming to the Creutzfeldt-Jakob disease, it is a most common human form of rare fatal brain disorders affecting people and certain other mammals. The variant Creutzfeldt-Jakob disease, that is the mad cow disease, occurs in cattle and has been transmitted to people under certain circumstances. And the symptoms are rapidly fatal disorder that impairs memory and coordination and causes behavior changes. And the changes in the brain we usually see are the results from misfolded prion protein that causes a domino effect, in which the prion protein throughout the brain misfolds and thus malfunctions. This is a very fatal disease, and in this condition there is no particular treatment, and the patient dies within a few months' time in Creutzfeldt-Jakob disease. And the diagnosis is there is no single test or any combination of tests that can conclusively diagnose sporadic Creutzfeldt-Jakob disease in a living person, but the following tests may help determine whether an individual has Creutzfeldt-Jakob disease, such as electroencephalogram measures the brain's pattern of electrical activity, similar to the way an electrocardiogram measures the heart's electrical activity, and the brain magnetic resonance imaging MRI can be used. We can detect certain brain changes consistent with Creutzfeldt-Jakob disease. Then lumbar puncture tests spinal fluid for the presence of certain proteins, and protein misfolding cyclic amplification, that is PMCA, which is an amplification technique for the detection of misfolded protein aggregates. Now coming to other causes of dementia, we have an HIV infection, that is AIDS dementia complex. It's a condition that leads to the loss of intellectual ability, such as memory, judgment and abstract thinking. It can also cause changes in personality. And the AIDS dementia complex is a type of dementia that occurs in advanced ages of AIDS, that is acute immunodeficiency syndrome. And these are some of the first signs and symptoms of ADC, that is short attention span, trouble remembering, poor judgment, slow thinking and longer time needed to do tasks. The patient will be irritable, unsteady gait, tremor or trouble staying balanced, which is also seen in Parkinson's induced dementia, poor hand coordination and social withdrawal or depression. In later stages, you may have more serious symptoms such as extreme mood swings, psychosis, or loss of bladder and bowel control. And treatment, just as there is no cure for AIDS, there is no cure for AIDS dementia complex. However, ADC can be controlled in some people by other appropriate treatments, and the most important treatment is effective ART. Coming to normal pressure hydrocephalus, the symptoms include difficulty walking, memory loss and inability to control urination. And the brain changes is caused by the buildup of fluid in the brain and can sometimes be corrected with surgical installation of a shunt in the brain to drain excess fluid. Coming to nutritional, example Wernicke-Korsakoff, thiamine deficiency, B12 deficiency, folic acid deficiency. In Wernicke-Korsakoff syndrome, Korsakoff syndrome is a chronic memory disorder which is caused by severe deficiency of thiamine. The most common cause is alcohol misuse, and symptoms will be brain memory problems may be strikingly severe while other thinking and social skills seems relatively unaffected, and brain changes. Thiamine helps brain cells produce energy from sugar. When thiamine level falls too low, brain cells cannot generate enough energy to function properly, and with the administration of thiamine or vitamin B12, and the symptoms usually reversible. Metabolic disorders such as hepatic diseases, thyroid diseases, parathyroid diseases and Cushing syndrome can also cause dementia. Now coming to chronic inflammatory causes. Example, collagen vascular diseases, vasculitis, multiple sclerosis is also known to cause dementia in some cases. Trauma such as head injury, punch can also cause dementia. And coming to punch drunk syndrome, a condition that is set in boxes and alcohol is caused by repeated cerebral concussions and characterized by weakness in lower limbs, unsteadiness of gait, slowness of muscular movements, head tremors, hesitancy of speech and mental dullness. The boxer's encephalopathy, that is the dementia publicitia, a syndrome affecting 10-20% of professional boxers, which is a cumulative result of recurrent brain damage and progressive communicating hydrocephalus due to extrapyramidal and cerebellar lesions that translate into dysarthria, ataxia, tremors, pyramidal lesions causing mental deterioration and personality changes. Example, rage reaction and morbid jealousy, that is also called Othello syndrome. In other causes, it can be occur as a symptom of more widespread degenerative disorders, such as in Huntington's disease, diffuse Lewy body disease, progressive supranuclear palsy, motor neuron disease, etc. Now, when coming to dementia with Lewy body disease, it has symptoms. People with dementia with Lewy body disease can often have memory loss and thinking problems common in Alzheimer's, but are more likely than people with Alzheimer's to have initial or early symptoms such as sleep disturbances, well-informed visual hallucinations, and muscle rigidity or other Parkinsonian movement features. And the brain changes. The Lewy bodies are abnormal aggregations or clumps of the protein alpha synuclein. When they develop in the brain cortex, dementia can result. And the alpha synuclein are also aggregates in the brains of people with Parkinson's disease, but the aggregates may appear in pattern that is different from dementia with Lewy's bodies. So that's how we differentiate between the two. Then tumors such as subfrontal meningioma. But dementia rarely may occur due to intracranial tumor. It's very rare, especially when tumors occur in certain anatomical sites. Mental or behavioral changes occur in 50-70% of all brain tumors, as distinct from dementia, which is associated with frontal lobe tumors, third ventricle tumors, and corpus callosum tumors. And cognitive impairment also occurs as non-metastatic complication of systemic malignancy. Coming to Huntington's disease. Huntington's disease is a progressive brain disorder caused by a single defective gene or chromosome 4. Symptoms including Huntington's chorea, dysarthria, dysphagia, facial twitching, chameleon or trombone tongue, as a severe decline in thinking and reasoning skills, and irritability, depression and other mood changes. And the brain changes in Huntington's disease is a gene defect causes abnormalities in brain protein that over time leading to worsening of symptoms. And mixed dementia. In mixed dementia, abnormalities linked to more than one type of dementia occur simultaneously in the brain, that is, the brain changes that is characterized by the hallmark abnormalities of more than one type of dementia, most commonly Alzheimer's disease and vascular dementia, but also other types such as dementia with Lewy bodies. So Lewy body disease and Huntington's disease, there is no reversal of dementia. It is basically, we can't reverse the dementia in these conditions. Even in mixed dementia also, we can try to restrict the progress of the disease, but as I said, we can't, there is no treatment for such dementias as well.